I said, "Hey man, now, can I ask you about those?" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "What? Help me understand." I said, "Nobody was doing that. Nobody was doing that when I was your age." I said, "Help me understand it." He said, "Well, you know," he said, "I can't talk for everybody." He goes, "I don't know why everybody else cuts themselves." He goes, "But I can tell you why I do it." He said, "The reason I do it is because I feel like I'm invisible." He said, "I feel like nobody listens to me. Nobody hears me." He said, "I feel like I'm in a room with my family and like I'm not even there." And he says, "I start talking and I feel like that they don't even hear a word I say." And he says, "And so I take the razor blade and I cut myself and as a way to say, 'Can you hear me now? Do you see me now?'" And I was like, and I didn't really know what to say to that except just a, you know, the normal thing that is very true and very powerful is that, hey man, God loves you and you're not invisible. And, you know, I was like, "Hey, has that one time ever helped you? Has that one time, you know, that voice in your head that tells you these things and then you give in and you do it. But the moment you do it, you know, the same exact voice says, 'See, you're worthless.' You know, it was telling you, 'Do this, do this, do this. Oh, it'll make you feel better.' And it never does. And the same exact voice condemns you and puts guilt and shame on you after that." I was like, "Has it ever once made you feel better?" He said, "No, not once." And I said, "Man, yeah, it's time to just start believing the truth and not believing the lie. When that voice starts to talk, you tell it to shut up. Stop lying to you, you know?"
Amen.
And I'll never forget that because it stuck with me and I picked it. Yeah, it was hard for me. We tried to write the song Invisible. We wrote it 3 different times because I wanted it to be a special and powerful song because the first time, you know, we wrote it, I was like, it just wasn't really grabbing me. I like to write emotional songs, you know, that reach people emotionally. It just wasn't that. And so we scrapped that song. And then we tried to write Invisible again, and then it was a little bit better, but it still just wasn't what it was. And then this other guy, actually this outside writer who was not in the band, came up with these verse lyrics, and I kind of tweaked them, and I was like, this is it, and this is the song Invisible, and I finished it, and I knew I wanted it to be something to let people know that God sees us, that is why we were created. That the reason, the things that we search for in life, the things that we're looking for in life, we all were created the same way, that we have this search, that we're looking for things. You know, and whenever we feel rejected or we feel left out or we feel like somebody doesn't love us, I mean, it tears us up until we get, you know, so hard-hearted we don't care anymore. It tears us up, you know, when a mom leaves the house, when a dad leaves, when girlfriend breaks up with you, when boyfriend breaks up with you. You know, have you ever broken up with somebody? That doesn't really hurt all that bad. When they do it to you, it hurts.
Yeah.
It hurts. I experienced that way more than I ever needed to or wanted to. I didn't like it. And I coped with it in different ways. And some people, you know, are coping with it this way. But we all have that same search thing. Commercials and advertising companies, this capitalistic society that we live in, the United States of America, we basically have built this country on advertising and products that we sell to everybody. And they know how you were created. They know how you were made. They know that you're on a search. They know that you woke up and took your first breath and then you were looking for something. You don't know what you're looking for, but you're looking for it and you're searching for it. And they're like, and they'll show you. They're like, "You want to breathe? Here we go. We have the nasal spray for you. Oh, you're going to breathe. The only thing is you're going to pee blood every once in a while. But it's worth it. It's fine. Don't worry about it." You know, you see these all the beer commercials. It's like they never show everybody after 7 beers. They never show any of those people. It's always the 3rd or 4th beer. They're like, "Oh, ping pong!" You know, the 7th beer.
It's because they're asleep and they can't find you either.
They never show that guy. They don't want you to know that part. They only want to tell you half the truth, right? That's the way commercials are. You know, but they know they've tapped in. They know your heart. They know your soul. They know, hey, you're searching. I watched this documentary about Kurt Cobain last week, the lead singer of Nirvana, and he had these stomach issues. He had pain in his stomach all the time. And, you know, I don't know if they diagnosed Crohn's disease very much back in 91 or whenever that was, but I have a feeling that that's what I think it was. And he was hurting all the time. And he claimed that that pain actually was kind of what drove him, you know. It was one of those things like if he didn't have that pain, that he'd probably be a little, you know, lazier. But he was just always busy and always doing stuff. And but he was fighting this pain constantly. And then he one day discovered heroin. And he took this heroin and it made him feel better. And so he's like, oh, this made me feel better. Okay, cool. And short-term benefit, it made his stomach feel better. But no one told him, no one shared with him the long-term effect. The heroin eventually got its claws into him, chained him, enslaved him, and wouldn't let him go. I mean, if anybody knows anything about heroin, once you're in there, it's got you, and you try to get off of it, and you get sick. You're violently sick. Violently sick. And once it's got you, it doesn't belong to you anymore. You belong to it. It's a perfect metaphor for sin. Because sin actually always has short-term benefits. Always is nice for a second. But it also always has long-term consequences. Right? But see, righteousness is the exact opposite. Righteousness sometimes has no short-term benefit. Helping somebody, you know, across the street, mowing a widow's lawn for her, you know, going and hanging out with somebody at the orphanage who, you know, doesn't have a mom, doesn't have a dad, and just being their friend for a little while and paying attention to somebody. It's like, oh, orphans, they exist? Yep, they do. They're just waiting on somebody to love them. And you're like, well, I don't have time to adopt one. Who said anything about that? Just hanging out with them. And it has no short-term benefit for you, but it does have long-term benefit. You know why? Because God created us, and he knows what makes us tick, and he knows what we're searching for, and we'll search for it in music. You'll see a seventh-grade little kid. He'll be just wearing preppy, nice little clothes and looking all nice. And like, oh, man, he's a nice kid. He does really good at math. And then eighth grade comes along, and all of a sudden he's got eyeliner and is wearing black and black fingernails and earrings and a nose ring. You're like, what happened, Bobby? Did you watch The Matrix? No. Like, what in the world? And dude, that's everybody's story. Maybe you didn't put on black eyeliner, but you did something else. You know what I mean? Because everybody's searching. Everybody's looking. And everybody's discovering. There was a time when the drug addict didn't know what drugs were. There was that time. And then they discovered it. And no one will ever tell you the end result. Or when they do, you don't listen. When they do, you don't listen. Most of us don't listen. Our parents tell us, hey, don't do this. It's going to lead down a bad road. I keep my babies, they always love to stick things in the light socket or the electric socket.
Oh, no. Like,
that's a bad idea. You know, like, I don't understand what you're saying. Why is this a bad idea? You know, I'm like, oh, that's terrible. Don't do that. You know? And it's not about me trying to steal their fun. It's about me loving them. And about the long-term effects, the Bible says, as I said, it says the wages of sin is death. And the wages, what that means is it's like when we work a job or we work, we expect to get paid at the end of the week. You feel me?
Mm-hmm.
Expect to get paid at the end of the week. Well, death and sin, when the payment you get is death. And it always leads to that. I love the metaphor of cancer because cancer is one of those awful things that when it starts out, you don't know that it's there. Somebody can have cancer in the beginning and not know that it's there and it's not really bothering them or whatever. But cancer has one mission, and that is to grow and take over. It's to grow and take over. And that's what sin does. Because sin always starts out fun and funny. You got funny little stories, you know. I mean, I could tell a funny story like right now. Like the sin of lying is pretty funny in the beginning, right? It's pretty funny. Because see, like when telemarketers call me, they're like, may I speak to Kevin Young? I'm like, I'm sorry. He literally just died. He's laying on the floor right now. And right before he died, he spoke to me and said, please take him off of your calling list. And that would be a funny sin. But see, the Bible says this. It says, he, whoever is faithful with a little bit, will be faithful with a lot. Now, most of us have a really good opinion of ourselves. We think, man, if I just had more money, I wouldn't complain as much.
That's true.
If I could just find that girl that would love me, then I would be happy. Right? And then you get that girl and you're like,
I want more.
She's all right. You get that job, you know, you used to be making $10,000 a year, now you're making $50,000, and you're like, it's not enough. So then you make $100,000 and you're like, it's not enough. So then you're making like $500,000 a year, and you're just like, I don't know what I'm going to do. So stressed, you know.
Too many bills.
Come on, man. You kidding me? And that's exactly the way that sin is. Start small. If you're faithful, if you're unfaithful with a little, you'll be unfaithful with a lot. You stay up telling this one little lie here. You're like, oh, and then you get in a tight spot. And you're like, I'll just tell this lie. And then you get in another one. I'll just tell this lie. And then you get married to somebody. And you're like, I'll just tell them this lie. And then before you know it, your whole life is trying to keep it straight. You're like, I said it. Okay. Which lies have I told? Because the wages of sin is death. And all it starts out funny. I got funny drinking stories. I got funny drinking stories of me and my cousin being blitzed out of our minds and my aunt coming in the room and saying, hey, have you guys been drinking? And we were like, yes. She was like, don't leave. And we were like, okay. And then she shut the door and we go, we got to get out of here. So stupid. And that's funny at first. And and these beer commercials, that's how they are. They'll never show you the rehab. They'll never show you a life and a family torn apart by alcohol.
That's right.
They never show you that. Mm-hmm. It always starts funny. They never show you the long-term consequences. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. It is. That's the end result. So here's what I like to do tonight. I'd like for us all to take our fist and put it in front of our face. And I like to just, you know, there's this wonderful verse in the book of Psalms. David prayed this amazing prayer. It's just an incredible prayer that I love to pray. And it's this prayer where he said, search me, O God. Right? Oh, man. He says, God, search me. Like, look inside of my heart. Look into my life. Search me. He said, search me and know me. See whatever offensive thing there is inside of my life. See whatever you find in there that you don't like, that you don't approve of, and tell me that I may be forgiven, that I may be cleansed, that I may be washed, that I may become clean. Can we just silently pray that prayer with me right now? And in your mind, just say, God, search me. Search me. And whatever he shows you in your mind right now, in your heart, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take those things. There's things that he would say, hey, this is it's gone on too far. It's gone on too far. It started out cute and it started out funny, but it's gone on too far. It's gone on too long. It's time to take these things and let them go. I want you to take those things, whatever God shows you, and I want you to mentally and visually put them inside of your fist right now. Look into your fist right now at those things that God's showing you. And I want you to squeeze them and hold on to them. For some of us, it's obvious sins that we know are there. For some of us, God just showed us something we didn't even know. God showed us maybe you're bitter towards somebody. You got unforgiveness towards somebody. You didn't even realize it was there. You was completely unaware of it. And he's like, tonight's the night. No more. That's it. I don't want you carrying this anymore. I want you to let go. I want you to forgive. God says, I've forgiven you of a million sins. And now I'm asking you to forgive that one person of this one. And he looks at you and he says, you can do it. For some of you, it's other things. For some